Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Trauma and the Struggle to Open Up, From Avoidance to Recovery and Growth, by Robert T. Muller, narrated by Tom Perkins. Note to readers, standards of clinical practice and protocol change over time, and no technique or recommendation is guaranteed to be safe or effective in all circumstances. This volume is intended as a general information resource for professionals practicing in the field of psychotherapy and mental health. It is not a substitute for appropriate training, peer review, and/or clinical supervision. Neither the publisher nor the authors can guarantee the complete accuracy, efficacy, or appropriateness of any particular recommendation in every respect. Introduction. We love, we hate, we fight, we fear. Our close relationships shape the contours of our lives. They bring the greatest joy. They draw us into sadness. We fret we'll lose them. We lose them anyway. As children, they keep us alive. They bring the world color. They bring a lasting misery. Our relationships sustain us. They help us endure. They bring a heavy pain. They challenge us. How we navigate them forms character. The feelings they stir dot the ups and downs of experience. They remind us of who we are. They dominate memory. When they hurt, they consume us. When they don't, we take them for granted. They inform our coupling, our parenting. They chapter the stories that make up our lives. In a candid interview from a few years ago, renowned baseball pitcher and trauma survivor R.A. Dickey spoke to Canada's National Post. He shared his perspectives on books, baseball, and what it means to heal from childhood sexual abuse. In Dickey's words, "Ultimately, the thing that helped me find some healing was when I learned that life was not about turning the page or getting to the other side of something. It's about holding what is broken about the world and holding what is joyful about the world, and being able to take a step forward with both. This is living well in the moment, and that's what I've tried to make a discipline of." Relationships are at the center of human experience and at the heart of trauma. To hold the broken and the joyful, we must face the relationships that bring both. To heal from trauma is to embrace the truth of the past, the losses, the betrayals, the disappointments from those we trusted most. This book is about trauma. It is about the relationships in our lives that hurt and harm. It's about the ones that help and heal. Indeed, when we study trauma, we see what a double-edged sword relationships are. Trauma stems from them. Recovery depends on them. The most harrowing trauma happens in close relationships, but recovery can't happen in isolation. Relationships are both poison and antidote. This, in part, is why we see the avoidance of closeness in many trauma survivors. A certain safety comes with avoidance, but the price is high. I agree with R.A. Dickey. Healing doesn't come from turning the page. It comes from attending to the past and finding one's place in the here and now. It's not easy, even harder to do solo. Opening up, facing our history deliberately, authentically, this happens in the context of a healing relationship. How does this look from beginning to end? How does a shared telling bring recovery and growth? How does trauma therapy use the relationship to heal? That is the subject of this book. I get asked a lot, how did I develop an interest in trauma? I used to have a ready answer, one focusing on the intellectual side of me, my interest in research, clients, and so on. Perhaps true in part. But a more honest answer was something I appreciated only in my early 40s. My interest in trauma work stemmed from my past, my family's history. My parents were school-age children during the Holocaust. They grew up in Budapest, Hungary. As Jews, their lives were, at the time, in constant danger. And they survived only because of a combination of luck and the goodwill of non-Jewish family members who took great personal risks to help. As a young child, my mother was separated from her family, given false papers, and put into hiding with near strangers. a sensible strategy under the circumstances. With no family around for long stretches, she came terrifyingly close to having her identity revealed. Some adults were keen to betray her as Jewish. It was only a fluke that she survived. As for my father, his father was killed. And after the war was over, my father, still a boy, learned a trade and went to work. He had to help support his family. In my own consciousness, shaped by the stories told in my family, the legacy of the Holocaust was the loss of childhood. It's hard for me to imagine the terror my parents felt as children, terror so many others felt as well. The stories occupy a large space in my mind. Families cope with trauma in different ways. Many share stories about the past, but many cope through silence, protecting themselves and loved ones from the truth. The truth can be unspeakable. I use the term trauma throughout. What in particular am I referring to? This book focuses on the trauma that comes from relationships. These include disrupted early attachment, traumatic loss, maltreatment in the family, interpersonal abuse like domestic violence, and post-traumatic stress. Note that I will not be focusing on those traumatic experiences that come out of natural calamities, human-made disasters, traffic accidents, and the like. In each of these, an important trust has been broken. There are interpersonal losses or violations. Often there's betrayal, and the effects are felt for years. The treatment approach is relational, psychodynamic. It's grounded firmly in attachment theory, trauma theory, and the psychotherapy research that comes from both. It emphasizes the impact of family, both helpful and harmful, and the stories we come to live by. Since it's relational, it underscores the here and now in the therapy office, the challenges and conflicts that happen in the treatment relationship. With a relational approach, we focus a lot on how therapist and client affect each other. Sometimes it's apparent how everything moves along well. Sometimes the therapy falls off track. How the clinician uses relationship difficulties makes all the difference, and I'll look at how treatment might go better or worse depending on choices the therapist makes. The approach also encourages an honest, realistic stance toward experience, not blind optimism. Trauma is painful. It's a heavy load. There's no dressing that up. But it's a burden that can be understood, shared, made less scary, and eventually integrated. People who don't get help carry the burden their entire lives. Pacing is a really important issue in this book, that is, the pacing of therapy. Like I said earlier, trauma is hard to deal with alone. When therapists help clients find a way to open up, to share the pain, that eases suffering. But how do we pace this? There are many horror stories of people feeling coerced into opening up, revealing too much too soon. It only makes the client feel worse. Then there are those who avoid their own past, sidestepping the trauma for years. For many, it's frightening to face, or it feels disloyal to talk badly of family, or they've tried opening up, but nobody listened. We know from research, when people do address their trauma, they do much better. But how they open up, the pacing of it, how do we do this? Note, this research is described primarily in chapters 1 and 4. The key is in the relationship, the interpersonal stance the therapist takes with the client. This book walks through the relational approaches that help pace the process of opening up so that clients find the experience helpful, not harmful. Growth and development are also important themes here. It's clear that trauma therapy takes people down different paths. Of course, an important goal is recovery. We want people to feel better. But interpersonal trauma is complex. It touches people in different ways. It changes how they think about the world and their place in it. It shapes how they feel about family and friends, how they trust, how they love others, how they protect themselves. As challenging as trauma treatment is, it can bring to people new understanding about themselves and others. How can trauma therapy facilitate growth and development? This is something we look at throughout, emphasizing the growth that comes from self-understanding, namely, greater appreciation for our competing emotional needs and awareness of the link between our traumatic past and our relational world. Finally, throughout the book, I use case studies to help illustrate the treatment process. Note, throughout the book, when I refer to clients in a general sense, I use they, he, and she interchangeably. Case studies disguise all identifying information and are composites based on several actual clients. In a field as emotionally charged as trauma, clients and therapists affect each other. For both, painful feelings get provoked. I use cases to explore my own experience with clients, my feelings toward them, and the feelings they express toward me. The cases include the ones that went well as the ones where I struggled, and I'll talk about my therapeutic mistakes. Perhaps that's where we learn the most. Chapter 1. When the story is too painful to tell. A telling. Years back, I had a psychotherapy client who would say almost nothing to me. It's a strange feeling, sitting week after week alongside someone who speaks so little. Gaunt cheeks, pale skin, worryingly thin. When I began working with Maggie several weeks earlier, it was her family doctor who gave me much of the background story. During a physical exam, Maggie had refused a routine pap smear. An explanation on the risks of cervical cancer made no difference. She would have none of it. Her doctor assessed her for symptoms of mood disorder, started her on antidepressants, and decided to refer Maggie to me, suspecting a history of early abuse. In our very first session, when asked about her background, Maggie confirmed those suspicions. Her older brother had repeatedly molested her, she explained flatly, elaborating on a couple of issues, mostly related to her eating disorder, and then promptly shut down for the next few weeks. Excruciating is the word that comes to mind. Therapy sessions were cumbersome, painful, clumsy. I felt de-skilled, as my colleagues in the field of trauma say. With her purse resting on her lap, Maggie would often shake agitatedly or stare numbly at a corner of the room. I found myself starting her sessions with a feeling of dread. And on those rare occasions when she would cancel the appointment, I would secretly feel relieved. I gave up on asking her questions altogether, and often we just sat in silence. She was an enigma, nearly wordless, yet reliably taking time off from her responsibilities to come in for treatment, always punctual. And when I had to reschedule an appointment because of a conference, she confessed to feeling apprehensive, scared I wouldn't return. I received Maggie's first email to me as I walked back to my car after one of my daughter's theater performances. I found myself opening the message on my cell phone and scrolling to the top in near disbelief that I'd received this communication at all. It was to be the first in a series of such contacts from her. I read the top line, "I have something to tell you." And she did just that, detailing a disturbing history of sexual abuse from a brother who'd been cruel and unpredictable. Simply telling. In the sessions that followed, not much changed, because in therapy, change comes more slowly. And trauma therapy in particular takes time. Simply telling. Relaying the details of a hurtful past in a torrent of words doesn't bring relief on its own. Psychiatrist Judith Herman wrote about this in her seminal work, Trauma and Recovery. Patients at times insist upon plunging into graphic, detailed descriptions of their traumatic experiences in the belief that simply pouring out the story will solve all their problems. The patient's desire for this kind of quick and magical cure is fueled by images of early cathartic treatments of traumatic syndromes, which by now pervade popular culture, as well as by the much older religious metaphor of exorcism. The notion that, on its own, catharsis brings about healing, this isn't how change actually happens in psychotherapy. When clients rush to share details of their trauma stories, my concern is how they'll feel afterward in the time between therapy sessions. On the way home, as they think about the meeting, will they find themselves feeling ashamed? In fact, much later in our work together, I came to understand just how silent Maggie had always been about the abuse, believing she had no alternative, never having talked about specifics until the email she sent me. Yet the wish to unload is understandable. Finally, someone lending a sympathetic ear, perhaps for the first time. It's tempting to share. But opening up too quickly before feeling ready can lead to a sense of being exposed, humiliated, vulnerable. If unloading or simply telling isn't enough, if indeed it can make people feel worse for a while, then what kind of telling helps? An honest but safe telling, one that makes it possible to confront a cruel past, to share the burden with caring others, and in doing so makes traumatic memories, feelings, and losses more bearable. A telling that helps you face the emotional experiences and vulnerabilities from that past. A telling that brings about learning and growth, even if the process is a painful one. This is what's meant by opening up, what we'll be exploring. Maggie's emails kept coming, and while the next few sessions were still painfully awkward, indeed virtually silent, something had shifted. We'd found a way to connect, and it would work this way at least for a time. She would send me messages by email, sometimes focusing on parenting her young son, sometimes focusing on her eating disorder. And then she would quietly sit with me in my office when we met until she was able to go further. An honest telling. Psychotherapist Rachel Sofer also found it hard to speak when she started treatment. A grandchild of a Holocaust survivor, Sofer recounts her family's story in a moving 2015 New York Times piece titled, Our Secret Auschwitz. Referring to the silence of her childhood home as a heavy pall, she came to discover only at the age of 12 that her grandfather had been imprisoned in Auschwitz. Prior to that, the story had been kept from her. Guarding this secret, evading the truth, had become her family's way of coping with a dreadful past. In her words, "We were trapped in history and did not understand how or why. Confusing things happened without explanation. We didn't celebrate birthdays, anniversaries, graduations. We somehow knew not to try to get close. Intimacy was painful because you never knew when someone you loved would be taken away. The pact of secrecy kept us safe from the horror of the past, but it also kept us from moving on." When her own psychotherapist, who was normally on the quieter side, explicitly labeled the Holocaust as a trauma, one that affected every life it touched, Sofer began to recognize its influence on her. Instead of sugarcoating the truth, her therapist answered with an honest yes when Sofer asked her big burning question, "Do you really think the trauma of the Holocaust impacted my family, impacted my life?" Psychotherapy is a telling, a sharing of a very personal nature within a safe and secure context. But some things are hard to talk about. And reaching a place where you can tell your painful trauma story with honesty and openness can take time. There are truths that are enormously difficult to face. Still, recovery from trauma means, at some point, becoming honest about the past. With help, Sofer became able to tell her story truthfully. She became proficient in the art of truth-telling. It could only become so because her therapist was willing to call it like it is, and because Sofer herself became genuinely curious about her family's past, about her own history. The idea that psychotherapy requires honesty and openness shouldn't come as a surprise to anyone. But as Sofer's example shows us, telling a traumatic story honestly is, in fact, a lot harder than it seems. A psychological assessment procedure, known as the Adult Attachment Interview, AAI, illustrates this point. Based on the work of British psychiatrist John Bowlby, the potentially stressful interview focuses on early history and memory for personal life events, especially early relationships. The questions orient the person to think about instances when they were in need. At those times, how did their caregivers respond? When ill or at times of separation or loss, or when they wanted comfort or emotional support, or when they were frightened? By assessing their responses to these questions, we can see the person's understanding of attachment, how they think about the world of relationships, the way interpersonal needs are or aren't met. Central to this technique is that the technical stories, the actual facts, are far less important than the way the person makes sense of those facts. The individual's state of mind regarding their relational world is what matters here. Does the client become overwhelmed by emotion as he tells of his mother who selfishly isolated herself after her husband died? If so, maybe the person is still consumed by his anger at mom. Or given the same set of life events, does the individual put his mother on a pedestal, perhaps casting her as a martyr, a victim whose husband unexpectedly died, leaving her alone and isolated? Same event, different interpretation. Or maybe the story is told with a focus entirely on the father's death, a terrible event the client hasn't yet recovered from. When working with families in therapy, we often see that siblings from the same home describe events in very different ways. Even when there's general agreement on basic facts, there are disagreements around the meaning given to those facts. And in the end, their stories seem unrecognizable from one another. But an honestly told story is one that has balance. People who are classified as securely attached are balanced and flexible regarding relationships. They can look at themselves and their own interpersonal history honestly, even when painful to do so. They can see the story from different angles. They don't shut down. Using the example from just earlier, when the interviewee was asked whether he'd ever felt rejected as a child, a question from the AAI, this is the story he told. Did I ever feel rejected as a child? Pause for 5 seconds. Well, I kind of feel bad saying this, but I guess so. I mean, not that my mom did it on purpose. She got sort of depressed after our dad died. We all did a bit, I think. She hardly spoke any English and couldn't find work, and the construction company my dad was working for refused to pay out his pension. I remember one time my sister was in the washroom, and my sister, I guess she got her period. She was younger than me, and I felt kind of responsible for her. But I would have felt dumb going into the washroom to help her. I was 14, so it would have been weird. So I knocked on my mom's bedroom door for help, and she was drunk again, and eyes well up with tears. And she did nothing, no help. Told me to go figure it out myself, and she just stayed in her room. She did nothing. My sister was crying, she was scared, didn't know what was going on. I guess as I think about it now, I did feel rejected and hurt, it's true. As if we just didn't matter all that much. And I felt bad for my sister. She was just so scared and everything. I couldn't help her. I mean, I've done okay, but she's still got tons of problems. So, there you go. Pause. Woo. I wasn't expecting to tell you about all that. In this version of the same set of events, this young man, still pained by his past, would be classified as securely attached. Why? The hallmark of secure attachment is balance. Reflecting on events that were emotionally disturbing, does the person do so with balance? Here, yes. When asked whether he'd ever felt rejected as a child, he tells how his mother's incapacitation left her unable to help, how she was unresponsive to his calls for assistance. And in recounting these earlier life events, he's hurt. He feels pained, yet he also has empathy. He's neither so overwhelmed by his feelings that he's stopped from telling the painful story, nor is he minimizing it or putting a positive spin on it, by perhaps telling it as an example of how cleverly he helped his sister in the end. His telling is honest. It rings true. The emotions are consistent with the remembered events. The speaker neither defends mom as some kind of martyr nor vilifies her without reason. He lives in a world where relationships matter, and his mother's failure to be there for him and his sister when they needed her most deeply hurt. Told like this, the story adds up. Still, hearing this account, one might worry for him, whether in intimate relationships he'll show signs of what Bowlby called compulsive caregiving. Will he try to take care of others to make up for earlier losses and hurts? In this example, the young man would be categorized as earned secure, a version of secure attachment in which the person has suffered much adversity but has found a flexible way to make sense of those events, an attribute necessary for resilience. The sudden death of his father and his mother's later depression had a big impact on him. And yet there is in him a certain maturity, an ability to step back and share his story with authenticity. Some people can manage this, but for most, this is a very tall order. Secure attachment, rare in trauma survivors. As I said earlier, telling a traumatic story with honesty and openness is a lot harder than it seems. Among trauma survivors, secure attachment is more the exception than the rule. Studies that have recorded different attachment patterns among people with high-risk histories show that relatively few trauma survivors are securely attached, and few are able to tell their story, to talk about their distressing past without great difficulty. My colleague, psychologist Catherine Klassen, and I have looked at this very issue in a clinical research initiative at Women's College Hospital in Toronto, Ontario. The Women Recovering from Abuse program is an 8-week group therapy model that focuses on safety and stabilization skills. It takes place over 4 half-days each week and uses a continuous enrollment process so that every week 1 or 2 women start treatment while 1 or 2 group members complete the program. Before they received therapy, we conducted extensive testing, looking at the attachment patterns of a group of these women, all of whom had profound histories of interpersonal trauma and were psychologically symptomatic, for example, depression, anxiety, relationship problems. Using well-trained and reliable coders who were experienced in attachment classification, we found that only 8% of these very high-risk women were rated as having a secure attachment orientation. And our results aren't unusual compared to the work others are doing in the field. A study funded by the National Institute of Mental Health also investigated highly symptomatic women with histories of childhood physical or sexual abuse, and found similarly low levels of secure attachment, about 17%, especially among the ones who showed symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, from their early abuse. Studies that have recorded attachment patterns among those with very high-risk histories haven't only looked at treatment-seeking, psychologically symptomatic people. This is important because one might argue that, by virtue of being in psychological distress, symptomatic and seeking psychotherapy, these people might appear insecure in their interpersonal relationships. When trauma survivors aren't in psychological distress, when they aren't symptomatic and seeking treatment, do they fare better in terms of their attachment patterns? We certainly know of such people. What does research say about those who have suffered a terrible past, but who are simply progressing routinely with their lives out in the community? How do they compare regarding their attachment orientation? Similarly to the treatment-seeking group, it turns out, as before, only a minority are securely attached. My students and I discovered this when I was working at the University of Massachusetts in Boston. In a study we conducted locally, we screened female and male adults and confirmed a history of childhood physical or sexual abuse among a subset of individuals. These were community members who were neither treatment-seeking nor clinically symptomatic. They were mostly working-class people, willing to give a half-day of their time for nominal reimbursement. What we found was very similar to these findings. Among people with high-risk histories of trauma, about 24% were scored as secure in their attachment patterns. That means 3/4 were not secure. And these findings were virtually identical to those reported independently by psychologist Robin Lewis and colleagues working in Virginia. Few trauma survivors were classified as securely attached. If you compare these findings to other studies, low-risk adults are far more likely to be classified as securely attached at levels around 58%. In other words, trauma puts people at greater risk for insecure attachment. Note, by low risk, I mean people from community samples not selected for any clinical disorder or history of trauma. So it seems that whether adult trauma survivors are psychologically distressed and treatment-seeking or not, among people with early histories of interpersonal trauma, only a minority show the secure attachment pattern. From this, we learn just how unforgiving relational trauma can be. When we've experienced a cruel past, we're left insecure in our interpersonal world. Relationships, sex, closeness, parenting are all profoundly affected. And the way we think about and understand our relationship history is affected as well. Indeed, the very ability to talk about our past in a balanced way, to be honest and open about times when we experience traumatic loss, hurt, or fear, the ability to freely reflect on such moments and how they've influenced our interpersonal lives, is greatly hindered. And it's very hard to cope with something when that something can't even be talked about. When the expectation is to stay silent. So, telling a traumatic story, honestly and openly, is a lot harder than it seems. But all this leads to the question, why tell at all? Because in the long run, holding it in doesn't work. In the next few chapters, we'll take a detailed look at the coping strategy of avoidance, how it appears in practice, and why people engage in it altogether. But for the moment, let's consider an example of what telling might look like in families where the expectation is to hold in thoughts and feelings surrounding interpersonal trauma. In such homes, the script is to pretend, to shut down trauma-related feelings. Rigidity and defensiveness dominate over honesty and openness, and it can be very difficult when one family member has a very different way of seeing the past, a way that doesn't mesh well with the view held by the rest. That person is often cast as a troublemaker. In my clinical work, I've had families come see me when trauma incidents were recently revealed. And often the one who insists on rocking the boat is scapegoated by others in the family, leaving that person feeling alone and isolated, as though the insistence on speaking the truth somehow makes them crazy. There can be a family expectation to minimize interpersonal trauma, to stay silent. In 1 Million Tiny Plays About Britain, playwright Craig Taylor depicts the rift that arises between family members as he walks us through a tortured conversation between mother and son in the wake of family trauma. The setting is a Manchester hospital room where Alex, a young adult, is a patient. His mother is by his bedside. One after another, mother shows Alex all the get-well cards he's received, reading aloud everyone's upbeat messages. Unquestionably earnest, the mother wants nothing more than for her son to be happy. She tells him how flowers would make the hospital room less dark, that winter doesn't last forever, and how supportive everyone has been. The cards Alex received are filled with platitudes, think sunny thoughts, and turn that frown upside down. Soon we come to understand how Alex ended up in the hospital as his mother innocently asks him about his hand. He answers her with cold irritation, "It's my wrist, it's not my hand." And with that, we realize the truth. He'd tried to slit his wrists. He'd tried to kill himself. And how does his mother cope with the truth, with the near loss of her son? "I thought it best to keep it in the family," she says, suggesting a pattern of secrecy, of cover-up, later dismissing the contents of his suicide note as something he couldn't possibly have meant. Tragically, the attempt to make her son feel better, to fix him, makes him feel worse. Soon she gives him another get-well card, this one from his sister, a drawing of a man with a big chin. The caption reads, "Chin up." As painful discussion is shut down, what Alex doesn't receive is a much-needed sense of validation. His family is ill-equipped. In the aftermath of such crises, in many such families, there's an attempt to sweep the secret under the rug, forgetting about it, pretending it never happened at all. To tell one's painful story but to have it dismissed or minimized can become an exercise in frustration and re-traumatization. In this way, even an honest telling that falls on deaf ears is doomed. A shared telling. Let's think back to Rachel Sofer's story from earlier in the chapter. Recall that her family had silenced the truth for decades. To not know that her own grandfather had gone through the Holocaust and that he'd spent part of his life in a chronic state of terror meant not knowing her family at all. Recall also that, over time, Sofer came to recognize the truth of her family's past because she became interested in her own history, wishing to have it covered up no more. But equally important, Sofer was fortunate enough to have someone to help her through it all. It would be impossible to overstate the helpfulness of interpersonal support in the aftermath of trauma, to have someone share in the experience. In his work exploring PTSD recovery in combat veterans, war correspondent Sebastian Younger showed how, in societies with high levels of interpersonal support, PTSD rates tend to be quite low. This is seen when combatants return from a tour of duty and feel a sense of acceptance rather than alienation. In Younger's view, being part of a tribe to help you through can make all the difference. And from his own personal experience of living in New York City in the wake of the 9/11 attacks on the World Trade Center, Younger observed a dramatic, albeit temporary, increase in interpersonal support in the community. He described this in a Canadian Broadcasting Corporation interview in May of 2016, explaining that people came together in a way they hadn't before. They felt needed by others. Recovery from trauma is hard to do alone. As I said before, psychotherapy is a telling, a personal sharing. The relational aspect of psychotherapy is central to healing. Psychotherapists from different schools of thought, who tend to disagree on a lot, still agree that the connection between clinician and client can make or break treatment. Different reasons are given for this. Therapists from the cognitive behavioral school tend to view good rapport and collaboration as necessary for treatment strategies to be accepted by the client. That is, a good psychotherapy relationship makes it easier for clients to take in new learning and skills. In contrast, more experiential, psychodynamic therapists tend to emphasize the therapy relationship as curative in its own right. A good relationship heals. Experience tells me both are true. In my first treatment book, Trauma and the Avoidant Client, I said that the therapist-client relationship is central to good outcome in psychotherapy, and research in the field supports this idea. A statistical technique known as meta-analysis has had a great impact on health and mental health research, and psychotherapy research in particular. Originally developed independently by statisticians Gene Glass, who worked in educational psychology, and John Hunter, who studied personnel selection, the technique is used to gather findings across studies. This proved to be especially important in the area of psychotherapy outcome research because, over the years, there have been so many different kinds of psychotherapy with widely differing claims regarding its benefits. It was critical to see if such claims had merit. Glass co-published the first meta-analysis on the benefits of psychotherapy in the late 1970s, but among the most exhaustive works on the topic is psychologist Bruce Wampold's The Great Psychotherapy Debate. Summarizing the many meta-analyses that have looked at psychotherapy outcome, Wampold found that relationship factors, such as the alliance between clinician and client, were much more important in a successful treatment than anything else the therapist had control over. And these findings have been corroborated repeatedly. A good therapy relationship, where there's empathy, warmth, acceptance, and encouragement, was found to be much more helpful than the specific school of thought the clinician used. Nowhere is the therapeutic relationship more valuable than in recovery from interpersonal trauma. The opportunity to share with someone who is non-judgmental, who takes one story seriously, who listens without overreacting, and who can help find new perspectives, such an opportunity can be life-altering. In Trauma and the Avoidant Client, I wrote, Clients who have experienced considerable rejection and hurt in their families of origin, rejection that has gone unacknowledged and unresolved, need a safe context within which they are given the opportunity to experience relationships in new ways. When safety and security characterize the therapeutic relationship, such interaction may represent the client's first occasion to experience support, encouragement, and emotional vulnerability with an empathic other. A few years ago, some of my graduate students in the Trauma and Attachment Lab at York University became interested in studying the therapeutic relationship in trauma treatment. In partnership with several local community mental health agencies, we developed a project to look at this. How do clients and their therapists feel about each other and their work together? We looked at children getting therapy for post-traumatic symptoms due to recent sexual abuse and other traumatic events. As part of their treatment, these children were invited to put together a trauma narrative. Developed by psychiatrist Judith Cohen and psychologists Anthony Manarino and Esther Deblinger, this approach helps clients tell their trauma story in written form in collaboration with the clinician. Importantly, the therapist never disagrees with the client or makes suggestions on how remembered events unfolded. Rather, the clinician helps the person make sense of subjective experiences. For example, if this or that event is recalled, if the individual made this choice or that, fought back or didn't, what does it mean to them? What does the client worry it says about them or about their future? And how can they start putting their feelings about themselves and their traumatic story into context? The trauma narrative is really hard to do, and the therapists on our team were worried. After all, their clients were just kids, young girls and boys who'd been sexually abused. And here we were inviting these vulnerable children to talk about very disturbing experiences. Previous research by Cohen and colleagues had shown this to be a promising approach, as long as safety and stabilization strategies, which we taught them, were established first, an important treatment component to be discussed in later chapters. Still, we wondered about the wisdom of what we were doing. Many tense discussions among members of the clinical and research teams led to the same questions. By encouraging children to talk about their traumatic experiences, would we re-traumatize them? And would they become so distressed that they would psychologically push their therapists away? What we found was just the opposite. Children improved, no re-traumatization. During the period of assessment and treatment, these high-risk children showed reductions in post-traumatic symptoms, which remained low even months after treatment ended. This is what we were hoping for, and what prior research had shown. So we weren't exactly shocked, although we were relieved. But what was especially different here was our examination of the therapeutic relationship. Recall that these young, vulnerable children were invited to write about their painful traumatic experiences, and we didn't know what this would do to the working relationship between children and therapists. Their clinicians were supposed to be people kids would trust. By engaging in these trauma narratives, would children come to view their therapists?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.